The carnivore diet is helping tens of thousands of people, if not more, lose fat that they never thought they could burn, reverse chronic medical conditions that they thought they were stuck with for life. So if that sounds good to you, this video is going to help you understand how to do a carnivore diet properly and not make these 15 common mistakes that most people make when they're first getting started. I'm Dr. Ken Berry, a family physician with 20 years of clinical experience, and that's what this video is about. Now, the carnivore diet is the ultimate low-carb diet. It is a subset of a ketogenic diet. Most people's ketogenic diet limits total carbohydrates to 20 total grams a day or under. The carnivore diet turns down your carbohydrate intake knob as far down as you can possibly take it. And it also removes all of the anti-nutrients and plant toxins that many, many people are sensitive to, allergic to, or actually react quite violently to, and they don't even have a clue. So let's get into the 15 most common carnivore diet mistakes. I tried to be as comprehensive in this video as possible. The last mistake is a little bit controversial, and I hope it doesn't offend anyone. Now, let's get into this. Number one is forgetting that seafood, eggs, and butter are carnivore. So many people think, oh, it's just red meat. It's just steak. It's just ground meat. That's what carnivore is. If something is a part of an animal, was a part of an animal, or it is a product produced by an animal, it is technically carnivore. A lot of people say honey is carnivore because it's produced by an animal. Honey is bee vomit. So I don't recommend you eat the vomit of any animal, including honey. And honey is also super high in carbohydrates, so that pretty much cancels it out from this ultra low carb way of eating. The eggs and the butter, that'll come in very handy in later mistakes that people make about the carnivore diet. Number two is eating too lean of a diet. Many of us come to this way of eating with the mantra of avoid fat at all costs. Eating fat will make you fat. Those are just not true, but you may have that in your subconscious. So you may tend to unconsciously pick leaner cuts of meat for your carnivore diet. Not only is it absolutely unnecessary, it can be quite detrimental to your progress and to your success. When you're eating a carnivore diet, you're not burning carbohydrates as fuel. You're not burning sugar because you're not eating any. Now, your liver can still produce some, which is perfectly normal and actually a good thing, but you're not getting the huge amount of sugar that most people get in their diet, so you are forced to burn fat as fuel. Now, if you have a lot of stored fat, that's actually the fat you want to burn, but as you're starting carnivore and as you're transitioning, and then as you're doing weight maintenance after you've lost any excess fat that you may need to lose, you need to eat, I recommend a 2-to-1 ratio of fat to protein by ounces or by grams of the thing you're about to eat. And that's where the yolks and the butter, so a lot of people can't afford to buy grass-fed, grass-finished, panda-massaged $22 a pound meat, but you don't have to. You can eat the best meat you can afford, and if that's the cheapest meat in the market, that's okay. Don't worry. You can still do carnivore, but you probably can't afford to add pastured eggs and pastured butter to that meat. And so by adding pastured egg yolks, whether they're chicken, duck, goose, it doesn't matter. It can even be robin, quail, dove, or hummingbird, but I would recommend sticking with the chicken, goose, and duck eggs because they're easier to crack, easier to eat, easier to find. But when you add a pastured yolk, you're adding a ton of fat because egg yolks have about a 1-to-1 fat to protein ratio. And so that's raising your fat to protein ratio of the meat that you're eating. Even a fatty meat like a fatty ribeye or 70-30 ground beef still needs to have some fat added to it. And so you might cook that in bacon grease or beef tallow. So you're adding pure fat to the leaner cut of meat. You might add some pastured yolks to that. You might add some pastured butter to that. You don't want to eat too lean on carnivore. Number three is not getting enough electrolytes. You have to understand our ancestors drank river water, stream water, mud puddle water. These are all rich sources of electrolytes, but they're also can cause a nasty infection these days. So we want you to avoid probably drinking mud puddle water Find a good source of electrolytes that you can add to your diet. I really like Keto Chow's electrolyte drops or fasting drops. There are many different brands out there on the market. Just all, when you're doing carnivore, you have to be an ingredient detective. You have to read everything that has a label. You have to read the labels and watch out for silly terms they use to hide ingredients you don't want in your body, like natural ingredients, because that can virtually mean anything. Number four is not getting enough omega-3 fatty acids. Now, we're really concerned with any spectrum of the proper human diet that you get a correct omega-6 to omega-3 fatty acid ratio. The average American is eating a 20 to 1 or a 30 to 1 omega-6 to omega-3 ratio. Very unhealthy, very inflammatory. Just the fact that you've eliminated all the industrial vegetable oils from your diet, that's going to lower your omega-6 fatty acid intake a bunch. You don't want to eat zero omega-6 fatty acids. You need some. They're actually good for you. You just don't want to eat a ratio of omega-6 to omega-3 that's too high. And once again, this is where adding pastured butter to your carnivore meal, adding pastured yolk to your meal, that's going to help up the omega-3 to omega-6 fatty acid ratio. Also, understanding that, remembering that seafood is carnivore. You can add wild-caught West Coast salmon to your meal, and you can add fish roe that to your meal. You can add cod liver to your meal, or cod liver oil if you can stomach it. Some people love it, some people don't. But that's all those things are going to give you more omega-3s so that you balance out your omega-6 to omega-3 ratio. Number five is organ meat. I know you may currently think it's gross, but I promise you, as your palate matures and kind of becomes a proper human palate, you're going to start to understand that that you can eat organ meats and they're actually tasty. One of the gateway ways to eat organ meat is a liver pate or a liver mousse, or even liverwurst that you buy at the store. These are excellent ways to start to incorporate some organs. Our ancestors ate all the organs they could get their hands on. There's actually, in the paleoanthropological research, they're starting to understand that the first stone tools we used were not spear tips and arrow tips. They were just big round rocks that we used to smash the bones and smash the skull of animals we were scavenging. We maybe even didn't kill the animals. We let the predators eat all the red meat, and then we would move in with our big rocks and smash and get to the brains, get to the marrow, which is very high in saturated fat, very high in omega-3 fatty acids. And so you need to be getting some kind of bone marrow in your diet, whether you're making bone broth or, if currently you're just starting carnivore and you're completely grossed out by the thought of eating any organ meat, Ancestral Supplements has a good line of freeze-dried organ meat in capsules, so you don't really have to taste it. I'll put a link to that down below. Number six on this list is not getting enough collagen. And no, dummy, I don't mean collagen powder. That's not okay. That's a waste of money, and the origin of that collagen is always suspect. There are many, many ways to get collagen in a carnivore diet. I've actually got a video about good sources of collagen that you can click on and watch after this video. But collagen is, so if you're eating eggs, there's a little membrane between the white of the egg and the yolk. That's pure collagen, okay? If you're eating ribs, whether pork, beef, or sheep, there is a membrane on the back of the ribs that most people peel off and throw away. That's pure collagen. Don't do that. If you're eating steak, eat the gristle. That's pure collagen. If you're eating chicken legs or chicken thighs or chicken wings, gnaw the cartilage off the end of the bone. Eat the skin. Eat all the little chewy bites, because that's pure collagen building blocks. And you need that in your diet so that you can have the beautiful glowing skin that most carnivores have. Number seven is watch out for imitation seafood. And so if you just blindly go into the grocery and buy some crab and buy some this and that, you have to, again, put on your detective hat and read every ingredient carefully. If you don't know what it means, do an internet search on that word and you'll be an expert on it in 3 minutes. It's very common for imitation seafood to have added grains, added sugar, and added industrial vegetable oils in there. and then different stabilizers and things to make the meat stick together. None of that stuff is part of a real carnivore diet. So make sure you're getting real seafood and not imitation seafood, and watch those ingredients and additives like a hawk. Number eight is sauces, marinades, rubs, and gravy. So if you've been eating a standard Western diet and you start carnivore, you may think, well, gosh, I've always put ketchup on meatloaf, so obviously that's how you eat meatloaf. No. You have to watch sauces and rubs and marinades and gravies very, very carefully. They very often are ways to slip grains and sugar and vegetable oils into your diet. You don't want any part of that. So here, any marinade or rub, you need to read the ingredients like a hawk. Almost every rub that's a dry rub that you find at a market is gonna have added sugar. And if you're putting a lot of that on your meat, you're eating a few grams of carbohydrates, and then also causing the inflammation that can come from eating that sugar, which is part of the reason you started carnivore in the first place. Number nine is eating out thoughtlessly. So it's okay to eat out if you're a ingredient detective and you are upfront with your wait service and tell them right off the bat, look, I'm allergic to sugar, I'm allergic to any grains, and I'm allergic to vegetable oil. Then you're gonna get a clean grill that your meat's prepared on. They're not gonna put any sauces or gravies or marinades or rubs on your meat because they don't want you to have an allergic reaction in the restaurant, because that's bad for business. But if you just assume that if you ordered a cut of meat, that there's not gonna be any sugar or grains or vegetable seed oils, you're wrong, because restaurants are in business to make money. And to do that, they have to make their food taste as good as possible to the most people as possible. And they do that by adding bad ingredients to the meat. So watch out for that. You can dine out, but you have to be very vigilant when you do. Number 10 is quitting carnivore too soon. For most people that I get feedback from, it takes 4 to 8 weeks of eating strict carnivore in order to really start to notice the awesome results that come from eating a carnivore diet. So don't do it for a week or two and then ass out. I promise you, you're missing out on something that's very powerful. Many people, for the first week or two they're doing carnivore, they could have some diarrhea or constipation. That's just your gut bacteria reassembling in the proper ratios. Don't worry about that. That's temporary. That'll go away. Some people have severe carbohydrate withdrawal symptoms, which some people erroneously call the keto flu or the carnivore flu. It's actually you just withdrawing to habit-forming carbohydrates and then maybe shedding some of the toxins from plants you've eaten in the past. That's only gonna last for a week or two. Electrolytes make it better. Salt makes it better. Eating more fatty meat makes that better as well. And then some people have a little bit of fatigue for a week or two. And typically that's when they're eating a diet that's too lean, not getting enough fat for fuel, when they're not adding enough salt and electrolytes to their meals. Number 11 is portion restricting. Now, definitely if you're coming to this way of eating to try to lose stored fat, it has been pounded into your head that you only need to eat a palm-sized portion of this and a thumb-sized portion of this. When you're eating carnivore, all bets are off. You do not have to do that. You can eat until you are comfortably stuffed. And so if an 8-ounce ribeye does not fill you up completely, get the 10-ounce. If that doesn't do it, get the 16-ounce bone-in cowboy ribeye, okay? You can eat as much meat as you want. You can add egg yolks, you can add butter, you can cook it in as much beef tallow or bacon grease as you want. You get to eat until you're comfortably full. If you don't do that, then you won't be getting enough fat, you won't be getting enough total energy in your diet. That's really gonna put you back into having the fatigue and the other problems that people have if they try to portion control on carnivore. That is not necessary. No carnivore in nature portion controls. They eat until they're stuffed and then they go take a nap. Our ancestors, there's no evidence that they ever portion control. Can you just see one of our ancestors 100,000 years ago saying, I'll just have a palm-sized portion of the salmon, please. And could you cut off the skin and the fat? That never happened. They ate as much fatty salmon with the skin on as they could hold, and then they went and took a nap. That's how we're supposed to do it. That's how you're gonna get the best results from doing this. Number 12 is watch out for processed meat. Now, if processed meat is all you can afford, that's still infinitely better than eating the Cheetos and the Doritos, okay? So don't feel like if all you can afford is bologna and hot dogs and Spam, do carnivore with that, but realize that's not a perfect carnivore, but you got to watch the ingredients. For example, if you just look at the 20 different choices of hot dogs or wieners in a supermarket, they could range anywhere from having 3 grams of carbohydrate per hot dog down to virtually 0 grams. You got to watch for grains, because if they add grains and sugar to a hot dog, for the average person, it's going to taste better and it's going to be cheaper to make. So yeah, they're going to do that. For another day, we can talk about the artificial colors and the artificial stuff, but watch out for a term called natural flavoring, okay? Because the big food manufacturers can use that to put any damn thing into the meat that they want. There's really no restriction on using that title, so you got to watch out for that. Sugar could literally be a natural flavoring. So look at the total carb count of what you're about to buy, and if it's more than 1 gram, try to find a better source. Number 13 is salt restriction. I know, your doctor and your dietitian and your mama all told you that salt is bad for you, you should limit salt. There's just no basis in scientific fact or paleoanthropological evidence to support that. All mammals love salt and crave salt and will walk for miles to eat as much salt as they want from a salty rock or salty mud. Our ancestors in the past always made use of the blood and the organs and the marrow, all which are very high in sodium, salt. So stop being afraid of salt. You want to use a good, reliable, natural salt. My favorite is Redmond's Real Salt. It comes from an extinct ocean that's protected under hundreds of feet of bentonite clay. So there are no microplastics or nanoplastics in Redmond's Real Salt. There are other good brands out there that are protected thusly. Number 14 is cooking too much. You don't want to overcook your meat. So if you're currently a well-done person, I don't want you to overnight start eating medium rare, but you gotta start cooking your meat less and less. The longer you cook meat, the more you break down the vitamins in the meat, and probably you're breaking up other important micronutrients as well. Don't overcook your meat. Eating raw is okay. Eating raw is healthy. You have this very sophisticated infection control device on your body. It's called a nose. And so when you take the meat out of the packet, you smell it smells super fresh. You take the salmon out, you smell it smells super fresh. Same goes for fish roe. Anything that you're going to eat raw, if you're going to make steak tartare, you want that meat to be very fresh and to smell very good. That's what your nose is for, is to protect you from eating ruined meat. Because I promise you, if an egg yolk or if a piece of meat or if some fish roe is bad, your nose is going to let you know and you shouldn't eat that. So don't be afraid to start eating some raw stuff. And even though that may gross you out right now, I promise, as you go along this carnivore journey, you're going to start to experiment with that. And that's actually a very good thing, because for the majority of our time on this planet, our ancestors ate almost all of this stuff raw. Your body's capable. You just got to slowly get back in to that mindset and that body set. And then number 15, and this is the one that's a little inflammatory. It may irritate some people, especially if they make thousands of dollars a month selling supplements, is you don't need to take a lot of supplements on a carnivore diet. Meat, especially organ meat, especially egg yolks, especially pastured butter, are the most nutrient-dense foods on the planet. So when someone tells you that kale is a superfood or spinach is a superfood, they are misled and misinformed, and they are perhaps unintentionally misinforming you. If you put up a piece of beef liver nutritionally against the same weight of kale or spinach, the beef liver is going to blow the kale out of the water. Kale is not nowhere near a superfood compared to liver, any liver, chicken liver, beef liver, goose, it doesn't matter. Liver is a multivitamin superfood. The same goes for egg yolks. If you compare the nutrition in a pastured egg yolk with any plant-based food on the planet, the egg yolk is going to win every single time. So that means you don't need to take collagen powder, because we already talked about that. You don't need to take an amino acid powder or a branched chain amino acid powder, or definitely a protein powder. You're getting all that if you're eating a good, real, whole food carnivore diet. You 100% don't need to take a fiber supplement, although some people think they do. If you're having gut symptoms, then you definitely don't want to take a fiber supplement. Carnivore is going to fix your gut symptoms, whether that's irritable bowel, both diarrhea and constipation based irritable bowel, whether that's ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, or any other of the hundreds of gut conditions. Carnivore is going to make it better unless you add a fiber supplement. You also don't need a vitamin C supplement or really any other vitamin supplement, especially if you're eating organs. All the livers contain a little bit of vitamin C. And we don't need as much vitamin C when we're carnivore. And the way you can know this is true is you can look at the tens and tens of thousands of carnivores who are eating according to my list. And they're not just eating deli meat that's full of the crap. They never develop a vitamin C deficiency. They never develop scurvy. Their teeth are strong and beautiful. Their skin is strong and beautiful and snaps back. Their bones don't become brittle and break because they're getting more than enough vitamin C in a well-formulated carnivore diet. I have several other videos on this channel about the carnivore diet that you can watch and check out. I'll have a couple pop up here and here at the end of this video. And you might want to click the subscribe button and the little bell button right beside it so that every time I post a new carnivore video, you'll get a notification from YouTube. This is Dr. Barry. I'll see you next time.